I'm going to look at the cryptanalysis of kernel. I'm going to discuss the fixes that are deployed briefly. And then I'm going to look at IOTA's response to our public, to when we publish this information. So IOTA, if you're familiar with Bitcoin, IOTA has a little bit different terminology. So a payment in Bitcoin is called a transaction. A payment in IOTA is called a bundle. Payment details, that is, who is paying and who is getting paid, are inputs and outputs in Bitcoin, and IOTA, their transactions. So if I say transactions, think inputs and outputs if you're a Bitcoin person, and if I say bundle, think transaction. And in IOTA, bundle is a bundle of transactions. The currency unit is one IOTA, like one Bitcoin or $1. And unlike many other systems, IOTA uses balanced ternary instead of binary. So by ternary, it uses base 3 rather than binary, which is base 2. So rather than bits, IOTA uses trits, minus 1, 0, and 1. And when I say trits, just think it's a variable that can be minus 1, 0, or 1. And instead of bytes of 8 bits, as we're used to, IOTA uses trites of 3 trits. So let's look at IOTA bundle, essentially a payment in IOTA. As I said before, it's made up of transactions, these are what we call transactions. So transaction one says from who the funds are spent and how much. So this is the funding input. And then the other transactions say where the money goes to. So this pays a bunch back to Alice, some to Eve, and some to Bob. Alice actually has to generate a new address. Signatures are one use only in IOTA because they're based on this hash-based signature scheme. So this is the format for an IOTA payment. And these numbers look like random, but we're gonna use them later. So how does IOTA's signature scheme work? Well, IOTA builds on this really cool signature scheme called Winternet's one-time signatures. WOOTS, or Winternet's one-time signatures, is entirely built out of hash functions. So if you want to play around with signatures, and you don't want to learn like abstract algebra or number theory, and you know what a hash function is, you can go and like build a signature scheme. It's really cool. But IOTA modifies Winternet's signatures with an additional step, that is to hash messages with curl prior to applying the signature scheme. So when we look at how IOTA will, say, sign a bundle, it takes the bundle, it hashes it with curl to create the hash of the bundle, and then it supplies that to the Winternet signature algorithm and generates a signature and returns SIG. So one of the big red flags for us was that curl is actually a cryptographic hash function that IOTA designed in-house. This is something that they built themselves added. The golden rule of cryptography is never roll your own. Cryptography is extremely unforgiving. As was mentioned earlier, new cryptographic hash functions require years of review by experts. The thing that became SHA-3, I believe, was developed over 9 years, but the SHA-3 contest was a 6-year contest in which over 64 candidate hash functions by experts were submitted. I was involved with MD6, and if you look at the paper, I wasn't involved with the submission, I did some math wrong. If you look at the submission paper, it's like this thick if you print it out. Like, these are extremely well documented, they have enormous amounts of security arguments, and then everyone just tries to break them. And so of these 64 hash functions designed by experts, many of them were actually broken. So it was like a tournament, to get to the end. And anyone, even experts, even the best experts in the world, can build crypto, they themselves cannot break. That's why we structure contests this way. That's why we spend so much money and resources to ensure that hash functions are safe. Extremely hard to get right. David, one of the founders of IOTA, wrote in response to our vulnerability, creating a new hash function is no trivial undertaking, even when it is being built on pre-existing world-class standards. Don't roll your own crypto is a compulsory ordered mantra. It serves as a good guiding principle for 99% of projects, but there are exceptions to this rule. When spearheading technology for a new paradigm, this statement is no longer axiomatic. Progress must march on. And so we had like full round attacks on Perl after like a few days of thinking once we realized they rolled their own crypto. So before I discuss how we broke Perl, I'm going to show how the breaks in Perl enabled attacks on the synchronous view. Yes.
Why did they do that? I mean, they didn't give much of a reason in apart from its breakthrough technology. What were their design goals with Perl?
So they have some statements, and you can read them from my memory. I understood, and now I'm just recalling, that they had two major reasons. They wanted it to be lightweight for IoT, because IoT is designed for IoT, and they wanted to support ternary. There are actually hash functions that have been designed for IoT and have been peer-reviewed, not as well as SHA-3, but they're out there. For example, RFID card readers often have hash functions inside them, cryptographic hash functions for doing signing. So those do exist. I don't know why they didn't use one of them. The only other reason I can think of is that they wanted everything to be ternary and base 3, and to my mind, there's no base 3 hash function out there. My take is that they should not have done that, but I believe that would probably... I mean, actually, you should read what their justification for it is. I'm just speculating.
Thank you.
So, consider we have two bundles. Remember, bundles are payments. And they hash to the same value. So that hash of bundle... So bundle 1 is not equal to bundle 2. It would be easy to make them hash to the same value if they were the same bundle. But if they're different, and they hash to the same value, this is very bad. Let me explain why. So we have the IOTA signing scheme, and we're hashing bundle 1, but if the hash of bundle 1 is equal to the hash of bundle 2, a signature on bundle 1 is also a signature on bundle 2. So if you can construct two bundles of hash, you get a signature on one, you get a signature on the other. And so we can just use signatures on bundle 1 as a valid signature for bundle 2. So here's actually two bundles that we created. The reason these values are here is that this is actually like real bundles. You can go on GitHub, you can see them, you can run them on the IOTA code to see that they validate. And so in the good bundle, 100 IOTA gets paid to use address, and the rest gets paid back to a fresh address of Alice's. And some gets paid to Bob's, because we just took a bundle, a pre-existing bundle that was there, and we didn't want to like do one from scratch. And then the evil bundle, way more money goes to Alice, and less money goes to Eve. So, as I described before, Alice says, sign this bundle and pay me 100 IOTA, and Bob, 50,000 IOTA, sends the bundle over to Alice. Alice looks at it, she inspects it, she's like, this is what I expect. She signs it, she sends the signature back to Eve, and now Eve can use the signature on the evil bundle. Signature 1 is also a valid signature for the evil bundle, and now she has taken this much IOTA from Alice, which Alice never agreed to. Now, I should point out that this is a chosen message attack. Eve chooses both messages. And this is an attack on the crypto protocol. IOTA wallets may not support signing a bundle that the wallet itself did not create. So, what does this collision actually look like? Well, the reason that these numbers are funny here is that on this side, there's a 0, and on this side, there's a 1. So at transaction 3, there's just a 1 trip difference between the two of them. And then over here, we start with a 1, and over here, we start with a 0. So we basically flip a trip here, and we flip a trip here. And so these transactions are exactly the same, except the two different spots, they're different. And the reason that we had to do two different spots was that the numbers have to add up. So it would have been easy just to increase this, but then more money would be created than it would be a valid IOTA bundle. So to perform this attack, require two bundles to hash the same value over Perl that were different by two-thirds. So now I'm going to explain how Perl works and explain how we performed the cryptanalysis of Perl to enable these attacks. So Perl is a cryptographic hash function. It takes an input of varying length and generates a fixed length output. Such functions are intended to be collision resistant, as we already discussed. However, Perl actually has a very strange design feature that they intentionally built into it, which is that Perl on zero inputs always generates zero, regardless of how long these inputs are. So if you have an input that's 486 zeros, it'll produce 243 zeros. It just, for all zeros, it always maps back to zeros. It's a fixed point. So defining collision resistance for it is a little bit strange. But curl is trusted not to collide for payments for bubbles. So our attack showed that we broke the collision resistance for bubbles, not just for zero inputs. So at a high level, this is how curl works. It takes a message, and it breaks the message into four chunks that are each 243 trips long. It takes the first, and we call these chunks message blocks. It takes the first message block, and it copies it into the state that's 729 trits long. So this whole thing is 729 trits. And this is actually all zeros. It's initialized to all zeros. It performs this transformation function on the state to generate a new state. It then throws away this top half, this 243 trit chunk, and sticks a new message block on top, runs the transformation again, and it just repeats this, always throwing away this top third, until the final step, where rather than throwing away the top third becomes the output. Generally, sponge constructions, like if you look at SHA-3 Ketchup, it's actually an XOR here, and this would have made our attack a little bit more difficult, but we almost definitely could have overcome it. I'm not sure why they throw away the state rather than XORing it in, as typically done. But notice that the security really depends on the transform function. Like if the transform function just does nothing, like it just doesn't transform, you know, the message will always just be your last message block, right? So the transform function is really the heart and soul. A good transform function, and this would probably be safe. A bad transform function, and this would almost definitely not be safe. So the transform function in curl takes two states, and it maps one state to another. That is, it generates a new state based on the first state. And the way that it does this is it takes the state, and it runs a round function to generate a new state, and it runs the round function again, and it runs this 27 times. To generate the last state. So really, you can think of this transform function as just 27 runs of this round function. And the way the round function works is it look for each position in the new state, which we denote n, it looks up two positions in the old state, calls an s-box on them, and I'll explain the s-box on the next slide, and then that's the new state. So it's a very, very simple construction. In fact, this is what it looks like if you write it down. It doesn't have the S box, but this is the pseudo grid for it. It's a very, very simple algorithm. So this S box takes one trip, and another trip. And then you just look them up. So for example, if the old state was zero, at the old state at position zero was -1, and the old state at position 364 was zero, then the new state at position zero would be one. So you just look up zero, and you look up, or you look up -1, and you look up, and you look up zero, and you get one, and that's the output. And this is actually a fairly small S-box. At least many of the older constructions use much larger S-boxes than this. So how are we going to create collisions in curl? All right, so this is the first observation we had when we looked at it. We said, hey, differences in the top third of the state are just like thrown away. So our plan is just to ensure that all the differences are in the top third of the state. So if you just get a difference in here, and if you have two things that are different, and they end up with different things here, it doesn't matter because it just goes down there. And the second observation is in round 20, remember there's 27 rounds of this of this round function that makes up the transformation here. If by round 20 for particular positions, there's a really high chance that most of the differences will end up in the last 30. So we know that if we start from a one trip difference, and we can just ensure that that one trip difference is just always just one trip in each round to the 20th round, we're pretty sure that we'll get a collision because all the differences wind up here. And you can kind of think about this like, I have a slide that will show it a little bit better, but the differences like slowly propagate out, and so if you prevent them from propagating to a certain point, when they fan out, they just won't fan out fast enough to spread across the state. So our plan of attack, we're going to start with a one trick difference between two message blocks, and then we're going to ensure by the 20th round that there's only a one trick difference in the state. So the first way of doing this is notice that if the inputs to the S box are 1 and 0 or 1 and 1, the output is the same. So if we can just ensure that like this number here is 1 in both runs of the program, and these two messages are like 0 and 1, then that difference won't spread. However, if this is 0, you actually can't avoid the difference spreading. So for rounds 0 through 8, we can actually just look and be like, well, we want this thing in the old state to be 1, and this thing in the old state to be 1. Let's just set it to 1. And then for round 2, now the S-box has been applied once, so we need this state to be 1, and this state to be 1. So it just turns into a system of equations where we can just like write it out. It's doubling each time. And so for just 8 rounds, you can write like a Python script that'll just like try random values, and it takes like maybe like 20 seconds to find a set of inputs. And then once you have that set of inputs, you can actually reuse it in many other attacks. You just have to solve these equations, and they're fairly easy to solve. Basically, the way we solve them is we just flip bits until it worked. And the nice thing is that there's chunks of the IOTA bundle which don't matter for validity at all and have no impact, so they're like perfect for this bit flipping. So we can get to the 8th round with only a one trip difference. How do we get to the 20th round? Well, it turns out the probability of a difference spreading is not that high in each round, so we can just run it a bunch of times. It requires about a few minutes of compute time. I had a really, really, really poorly written Python script that was saving all state forever, and that took about 8 hours. Taj wrote some Go code that was faster, and we ran it on a somewhat old 12-core box, and that took like a few minutes. And I think the best we got was on a really old 80-core machine, and it was like 3 seconds to generate malicious. So this enables us in minutes to create client bundles, and then these bundles pay out to different parties. The example I showed is a bundle that does this. And so you can actually see, this is a visualization. These are the number of rounds each time the round function is being propagated, and this is the position. So we start, I think it's hard to see, but we start out here with a single difference, and then the difference like propagates, and normally it just fills up the whole thing. This is sort of what a hash function should look like. It's very random. But notice that it actually takes a while to propagate. Usually when you're looking at a hash function, it actually propagates much faster, but that small S box causes it to propagate slower. So when we solve the equations, you can see that we get to round 8 with like no propagation. It's just one difference, one difference, one difference. And then once we brute force it, you can see that like there's very few differences. And for the last round, all the differences are in the first third, and that gets thrown away, so you have a collision. So in July, as I discussed, we disclosed this vulnerability to the IOTA developers. They agreed to a timeline to fix this vulnerability. On August 7th, the IOTA developers replaced curl in the signing function with a function they call curl, with a K. I don't know why they did that, because they're homonym, so it seems like it would, like generally, if there was a broken hash function, I would not name it the same, because, you know, it could lead to confusion to tell someone over the phone. According to the other devs, Perl, and this is just a quote from their documentation, is based on Ketchup SHA-3 with conversion to ternary. I haven't looked at Perl, and I haven't looked at Perl with a K in much detail. Perl with a C is still used for other functions. We haven't analyzed these uses at all, but they actually have a very helpful on their GitHub of where Perl is still being used, and this is their like homegrown crypto. So after we disclosed it to them, then they fixed it. A month later, we published it. And this was the first response they had. The attacks presented in Narula's paper, our paper, while being valid academic criticisms of the latest public version of the Perl hash function, do not represent valid attacks on the other cryptocurrency. These attacks rely primarily on Alice being able to goad Alice into signing bundles crafted by Eve, and then being faster at getting her bundle confirmed by Alice. Secondly, for Eve to be able to generate such a bundle in the first place, Eve would have to know which addresses belong to Alice. So, Alice could tell Eve that information, we agree that our attack is a chosen message attack, which is, these are the limitations of a chosen message attack. I very much disagree that having broken chosen message security is not a valid attack. It's a serious valid attack on IOTA. Implementers can no longer trust the crypto, right? For instance, multisig is a chosen message setting, right? Like, I have two people that sign this key. Well, one person's gonna have to generate the bundle of payment, and then the other person's gonna be one of the signers. And IOTA does support multisig. We haven't looked into it much. I did hear, and maybe someone in the audience can clarify, that Bitfinex uses multisig for IOTA. And it kind of makes sense that they would, because Bitfinex uses, I believe, BitGo for a second party to sign Bitcoin transactions. So I'd be really curious to know if they're using an additional party to do multisig for IOTA. But chosen message attacks are very serious attacks. And I think just the misunderstanding is a little bit worrying. It's like, we want to analyze crypto protocols as components. We can't look at the entire thing holistically because it's very hard to know when you've made a mistake there. You want to take them and test them and determine if they're strong, and if they're broken, they're broken, right? And then there was actually a second response from one of the co-founders of IOTA who wrote Perl. So while everyone looks at signature verification routine, the real verification happens in routine updating milestones. This trick, remember, resembles a focus trick as done by the magicians on TV. It works so perfectly that Neha Narula's team, us, was fooled despite of me explaining the essence of the trick numerous times. Being the creator of Perl, he refers to Perl as Perl P. Being the creator of Perl P, I knew his properties very well. I changed the number of rounds to allow practical collisions. So this is sounding like he intentionally made Perl weak to these attacks. With coordinator, IOTA security depends on one-wayness of Perl P. Without coordinator, security depends on collision witnesses. So IOTA has this coordinator that's a it confirms all transactions. They describe it as training wheels because they want their network to be secure while they're still developing things. They say they will remove the coordinator at some point, but he's arguing that the coordinator prevents these attacks. But if someone was not running the coordinator is closed source, you would not be able to prevent these attacks. This is a very important part. It means the phrase that IOTA development team deliberately introduced faults into IOTA codebase is wrong. IOTA is unaffected by the collisions of Perl P. Scam-driven clones are. So I think that means that if you were to clone IOTA, you were to use their free and open source software in your own project that you would be vulnerable to this. To provide an answer, are there other deliberate defects in the open source code that have been disclosed? It's not easy. I disagree with the choice of words, defects. If you mean the copy protection, which I think he refers to this as copy protection, then my answer is it's not smart to answer this question. And then the second response is, so he also maintains that he introduced similar vulnerabilities into the previous cryptocurrency he worked on, NXT. And there are articles where he talks about this. Vulnerabilities were discovered, and he said those were vulnerabilities he intentionally introduced as a copy protection mechanism. Remember how quickly NXT protection was disarmed? I was keeping in secret the fact of existence of such mechanisms in IOTA. I was pretty sure that the protection would last a long time because it was hidden inside cryptographical part, and the programming skills would be insufficient to disarm the mechanism. But nothing lasts forever, and finally the copy protection mechanism was found by Nahan Arora's team. And so the questions I have is like, did we discover a copy protection backdoor in IOTA? I have no way of knowing. That is what he's saying. If we take him at his back word, then that's the case. I kind of think it's cooler to have discovered a backdoor than to have like broken homeworld crypto, because generally homeworld crypto is just like obviously broken, but not that many people discover backdoors. Yeah, it does sound a lot like that. And then the second question I have is, cryptocurrencies are very worried about other people copying their code, but to gain trust, they often have to be open source. And so I sort of wonder, like, going forward, where do people feel the ethical lines are? Is it okay to design vulnerabilities into free and open source code as a copy protection mechanism? If you do this as a copy protection mechanism, doesn't it imply that you will then later exploit that mechanism against many people? And I would point out that this is like GPL code, this copy protection vulnerability that's been introduced into. So in conclusion, we broke the collision resistance of curl on IOTA bundles. We exploit this to break IOTA's signature scheme that shows a message attack. I should be clear here that IOTA's signature scheme has been changed and that this is fixed now. You can go to our GitHub. We have example colliding bundles and proof of concept of these attacks. You can run code, see that they collide. You can run code, see that they're valid bundles. And we have a full vulnerability report describing the timeline of our disclosures and more details. The cryptanalysis stuff is not in that report. We've been writing it up, but this is the first time it's been presented.
scheme. Would you explain that?
So I can try to explain it.
Can you repeat the question?
All right. So you're asking me to explain the copy protection mechanism.
No, what does that term mean?
So I can describe what I think Sergey means by it. For example, like Bitcoin came out, right? And it was successful, and so someone cloned the code and made Litecoin. Now, I don't see that as a bad thing, some people are very worried that the cryptocurrency will invest all this time and energy, and then someone else will just make another cryptocurrency that's the same code base and, like, you know, scoop them in some sense. So IOTA has a closed source aspect, which is this coordinator, which is trusted to approve all transactions, and which I think, if I understand this correctly, is able to change balances at certain times with milestones. And I believe when people send money to the wrong address, sometimes they'll be able to send it back. So they have this coordinator that's closed source. I have no idea how it works. And this is actually an interesting discussion about vulnerability. Is like, you know, we looked in their code where it said like sign and verify. But later Sergey said that there's actually a different the real verification happens inside this coordinator that's closed source that we have not looked at, that we can't look at. So we just took the open source project and looked at it and worked from there. But I think what it means is that this coordinator is closed source. No one knows how it works. So if you just clone the open source thing, you'll be vulnerable. Now the question is, to use this as an actual copy protection mechanism, at least my thinking would be, then you have to exploit the person that copied your code. And to me, that seems like that may be a criminal act. So I'm not sure, like, exactly. Maybe you just announced the vulnerability exists or something like that. I don't know what you do from there. But my understanding is the copy protection mechanism that the coordinator is closed source and has some additional prevention mechanisms that counteracts the vulnerabilities. And so if you take this GPL code and use it in your project, all of a sudden there are vulnerabilities that are built into it that they don't have to deal with.
So as a user of IOTA, you're just trusting that code is moving. You don't know if it is good.
Yeah, I mean, they say that they will remove it at a future point. These are just training wheels. But at this point, I mean, it's a $2 billion cryptocurrency. So at what point do you make it a distributed, untrusted system? So I believe he was very much involved in the NXT. I'm probably going to get this wrong, but so his screen name has come from Beyond, and I believe his screen name in NXT was like BC Next. I could be, is that correct? All right.
I didn't know if it was
wrong. So I watched this video in which I think David from IOTA says that he can now reveal that BC Next is Sergey. I think similar to the problem of Satoshi, how do you authenticate that? But I think if you look into Sergey's post history, you may also say that it was BC Next.
There was someone called Come From Beyond talking in the NXT forums like 5 years ago, less than 5 years ago. 4 years ago, but yeah. Anyway, can you say a bit about the combinatorics, which allows you to brute force it once you've got from round 0 to 8?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. We kind of wanted to do more work on that, but So the question is the combinatorics of brute forcing this. How easy is this? How much work is this? And so I started sketching out. So this is just really easy. You can just check whether something satisfies these equations. But over here, to brute force this, basically there's a probability in each round that one difference will propagate to two differences. That probability is a little bit complicated. It's around 1/3. But one of the tricky things about it is that if the other difference, the one difference that remains, becomes, say, like a zero, you're, or actually, So basically there's a probability that the difference doesn't propagate in this round, and then there's a second probability, which is in the next round, is it going to be impossible for it to propagate or not? So we end up with this sort of like branching tree. I think when we worked it out, I worked it out for a few rounds, but then we just ran it and it like worked, so we didn't get into the detail. I kind of want to write it up, but it's like when something takes between 3 seconds and 3 minutes on a computer, it's like quantifying that security doesn't become a priority. But it's something like 2 out of 19 or something. Two out of 19 was a sketch.
How smooth are those combinatorics? Like, did you consider, instead of guessing randomly, having some like, predictive model or anything along those lines?
So probably you could do more analysis on that. We made this assumption that's often made in cryptography called the independence assumption, which is that things are random enough that if you like flip a bit here, it'll just have like a random change here. And so we just flipped bits at the top and it worked. But I'm sure you could go into more depth. It's just that when something gets broken this quickly, it's like how much time do you want to sink into like making the attack better?
If I understand correctly, the problem with the curl is you put two different inputs in and you'll get the same output, and then that can cause you to get like the same signature for two different transactions. But like, how would you then use that signature to sign two transactions? Like, can the signature only be used once, or can it be used for multiple different transactions?
So that's a great question. So if I understand your question correctly, You've performed this attack, and now there are two transactions, and the signature on one transaction works on the signature for another. And I think this goes back to what David was saying, which is that being faster and getting your bundle confirmed. So like one of the problems is you might have a race, right? There are now two transactions that are both valid, validly signed, and they're double spends. One way to avoid this, which David brings up in his message, is if Eve controls Alice's internet access, she could block Alice from announcing it. Or it could be the case that this is part of a multi-sig process, and it's not valid when Alice signs it. But it is valid when, Cynthia signs it, and so even Cynthia can announce the transaction, and Alice will never actually see a valid signature. But generally, in this research, we didn't want to like dive too deep into their code base. We just like focused on like breaking the crypto primitive as it was.
I guess what I mean is like, wouldn't all of the people need to be collaborating, and then it would be like zero sum? So like, you would be making fake transactions within a system of people collaborating rather than someone stealing someone else's money through this.
I mean, I don't think that Alice would be collaborating that model, and it could potentially be a transaction that costs Alice a lot of money.
So in essence right now, we could change the curl, eliminate that coordinator, and create a complicated high order?
So I don't know, and I think that's one of the reasons why parts are not going to be the question. So the question is, could right now you eliminate the coordinator, create a copy out of curl, and then have your own cryptocurrency? And I can't really answer that question. Maybe there are additional defects and vulnerabilities that would arise if the coordinator is fixing. I mean, you could definitely do it, but whether bad things would happen is unclear.
There are so many cryptocurrencies to look at. Why did you pick this one?
So, this is actually a funny story. I was talking to Tech, and we like went out for lunch. And he was talking about IOTA because there's been a lot of buzz at IOTA, and he said it was ternary. We're like, that's kind of interesting. Like, who does ternary? And then he was like, and they wrote their own hash function. I was like, wait, that can't. And it was like, no way. And so then we like walked back to his office and we looked at it and we saw that the like core of the hash function was just like this. Which like if you look at like HetCheck or other hash functions, like I've done some hash function work, and they're usually significantly more complex than like an S-box and a permutation. Or that the S-boxes are very large. There are substitution permutation networks that are very cool crypto. But like usually when you see something like that, and you look at the S-box and it's just like two trits being transformed into a third trit, I'm like, this can't be right. And so I think what I told him at the time was like, you just ruined my beginning. Because I love hash functions and breaking hash functions is like really fun, and like I don't get to do it that much, and I'm like I'm also really interested in cryptocurrencies, and now here's an intersection of these two things. So I went home, and then like Saturday night I like worked on it a bunch and was like, oh, this is vulnerable to like differential crypt analysis, and then sort of like off and on working with the team at MIT to figure out additional things. We got the like a full round attack. Noticing that something is vulnerable is not the same thing as turning that into a chosen message attack on the signature screen.
Yeah,
so, are there any serious hash functions which use a similar system to this, and how do they mitigate the vulnerability that you exploited?
So are there other hash functions that use a system similar to this? Serious hash functions? That's a really good question. There's actually like a lot of serious hash functions out there. And I looked at a few in depth, but I haven't looked at all of them. So I can't answer that. I don't think this system is necessarily bad, but you probably want much greater diffusion and a much more complex S-box. Certainly you'd want more rounds than 27. If you listen to Sergey's response, he said that was too few as it was. But I think there's a lot of other things that you'd want to do. Like you'd want to have each of the round functions be slightly different, so you couldn't exploit similarities in the round function. This uses an all zero ID, which is like, I don't want to say like unheard of, probably someone's done it and it's safe. But generally when you see hash functions, they don't have like an all zero ID, they have like pi or something, just to make it, and then that would make these attacks, they'd still be possible. I don't think that would actually fix these attacks that much, but having different round functions certainly would. But yeah, I think just this level of simplicity and the size of the S-box is I would be very surprised if there are, maybe there are. I don't know lightweight crypto, which is what a lot of IoT uses, and maybe they figured out some really clever ways to make simple things work.
Sorry, can you guys, since you know so much about this, following on that, there have been bad men and number generators that have real economic consequences for you to use it. The same thing happened with bad hash functions.
Yep. I believe the flame. Oh, so what bad consequences have broken hash functions caused? So MD5 is a hash function that was widely used. It was designed, it was peer reviewed, people looked at it for a really long time. I don't know the time scale that it took to break, but people just kept getting better and better breaks. The differential crypt analysis, which is what we used here, was actually used to break MD5. It's incredibly effective. It's like the first thing you should check when you're attacking the hash function. And I believe it was used by like the Flame malware to get certificates signed on a good piece of software, and then that certificate would also like sign a bad piece of software. So I think some of the NSA's Olympic Games in Iran used this to get around Microsoft's code signing. I think there was some like TLS attacks, but I don't remember them that well. But I think MD5 is the biggest example. There have been a number of attacks, and it's used just to get around code signing. Because you submit a good piece of software, and then they sign that, and it happens that a good piece of software collides with a bad piece of software. Or in this case, it's a certificate rather. So I just want to like, I hit this question, because cryptocurrencies are very new, and they're a little bit different than anything we've ever had before. Like, should cryptocurrencies have copy protection mechanisms to create, to prevent scam copycats? Like I think we should take this question seriously. I would suggest maybe not GPL code, and being more upfront about it, but, you know, if someone wants to do a cryptocurrency and they want to ensure that other people don't just take their cryptocurrency and do a pump and dump with it, is there a right way to do that, or is that just something we have to live with? I mean, I like Litecoin, and Litecoin is just a fork of Bitcoin, and I'm very much about that, but then again, like, you know, I'm not, well, I mean, Bitcoin before I had one, so. But I think that's sort of like an interesting, just a point of discussion.
So much, Ethan. That was really fantastic. And I was talking a little long in the beginning because I was waiting for them to get the live stream going. I wasn't sure it was on and off, but I think we could get it. So that was fabulous. Thank you, everybody, so much for coming. So I have somebody in mind for our next meetup in the middle of October, but I just want to make sure I get everything down and then I'll announce it on the meetup page. In the meantime, a bunch of us are going to Daedalus afterwards. So, question? Yes, we've already posted the video, the live stream, so the video should be there, and I'll talk to Ethan about getting the PowerPoint slides, and see if he says yes. So we'll get that up. And that's it. If you want to join us for drinks at Daedalus, it's right around the corner, please do. Thank you everybody so much for coming.
Yeah, leave a...